Good morning, friends, and welcome. This is a special day for us, the commemoration of the life of William Quan Judge. So this lodge is dedicated to carrying out the work which was initiated really by the masters of the wisdom of the ages, brought to the West by their messenger, H.P. Blavatsky, and Mr. Judge, and left to us through Mr. Crosbie in its pristine original form. And our mission is to carry out that work. It's ageless, and we wanted to pass it along to all who find it in the way it was presented to us. That's what on April 19th, we're having a special meeting over in Arlington, Virginia, at the Culpeper Garden. It's part of our outreach program. We meet here at 11 o'clock here in Bethesda, Maryland, every Sunday to have a particular topic presented from the writings. And next week's topic we have is a roundtable questions and answers discussion. And then the following week we'll be probably back online in YouTube with another talk. We're finishing up our program for the next quarter right now. Bombay Lodge, which when accounting for time differences, is also celebrating Mr. Judge Day about right now. They sent out fraternal greetings and all good wishes on the forthcoming occasion of Judge Day, which is now, when we commemorate the passing away of Mr. William Q. Judge. Though perhaps every day we contact his being and his mind through the teachings he left behind, reflection upon his life and work inspires and spurs us on to carry on the work with zeal, patience, and humility. For as he said, if the present is full of doubt and vacillation, so will be the future. If full of confidence, calmness, hope, and courage and intelligence, thus also will be the future. So now, from the reading on notes to the Bhagavad-Gita. All of us are brought to this study by our own request, made to our higher self, who is Krishna. It does not matter whether he now is consciously aware of having made the request, nor whether it was made as a specific act in this life or in many another precedent one. It was made, and it is to be answered at the right time. Some of us have asked this many times before, in ancient births of ours, in other bodies, and other lands. Others are making the request now, but it is more than likely in the case of those who are spurred on to intense effort and longing to know the truth and to strive for unity with God, that they have put up the petition ages since. We take up the gauge over and over, life after life, in experience after experience, never completely defeated if we always look to Krishna, our higher self. All the passing shows of life, whether fraught with disaster or full of fame and glory, are teachers. He who neglects them neglects opportunities which seldom the gods repeat. And the only way to learn from them is through the heart's resignation. And when we become in heart completely poor, we at once are the treasurers and disbursers of enormous riches. The attitude to be assumed, then, is that of doing every act, small and great, trifling or important, because it is before us to do. And as a mere carrying out by us as instruments of the will of that deity who is ourself. This practice is the highest, that which someday we must and will learn to perform. Effacement in the Supreme Spirit is gained by the right-seeing saint whose sins are exhausted, who hath cut asunder all doubts, whose senses and organs are under control, and who is devoted to the well-being of all creatures. If the last qualification is absent, then he is not a right-seeing sage and cannot reach union with the Supreme. It must follow that the humblest imitator, everyone who desires to come to that condition, must try to the best of his ability to imitate the sage who had succeeded. And such is the word of the Master, for he says in many places that if we expect to have his help, we must apply ourselves to the work of helping humanity to the extent of our ability. No more than this is demanded. Krishna says that those who, with the eye of spiritual wisdom, see that the self is all, begin to reincarnate with the belief ingrained in them. Hitherto, they had come back to earth without that single idea, but possessed of many desires of ideas and of ideas which separated them from the self. Now they began to return fully at rest in the self and working out their long accumulated karma. And at last they become a Mahatma, or great soul.
This is from the writings of H.P. Blavatsky. Harmony in the physical and mathematical world of sense is justice in the spiritual one. Justice produces harmony and injustice discord. Discord on a cosmical scale means chaos and annihilation. If there's a developed immortal spirit in man, it must be in everything else, at least in a latent or germinal state, and it can only be a question of time for each of these germs to become fully developed. There's a way to avoid reincarnation, and Buddha taught it in his doctrine of poverty, restriction of the senses, perfect indifference to the objects of this earthly veil of tears, freedom from passion, and frequent intercommunication with the Atma, soul contemplation. The cause of reincarnation is ignorance of our senses and the idea that there's any reality in the world, anything except abstract existence. From the remotest antiquity, mankind as a whole have always been convinced of the existence of a personal spiritual entity within the personal physical man. This inner entity was more or less divine, according to its proximity to the crown, Christos. The closer the union, the more serene man's destiny, the less dangerous the external conditions. This belief is neither bigotry nor superstition, only an ever-present instinctive feeling of the proximity of another spiritual and invisible world, which, though it be subjective to the senses of the outward man, is perfectly objective to the inner ego. Furthermore, they believe that there are external and internal conditions which affect the determination of our will upon our actions.
Echoes from the Orient, a broad outline of theosophical doctrines by William Kitchach. What appears to the Western mind to be a very strange superstition prevails in India about wonderful persons who are said to be of immense age and who keep themselves secluded in places not accessible to the ordinary traveler. So long has this been current in India that the name applied to these beings is well known in the Sanskrit language, Mahatma, a compound of two words, Maha, great, and Atma, soul. The belief in this in the existence of such persons is not confined to the ignorant, but it is shared by the educated of all castes. The lower classes look upon the Mahatmas as a sort of gods, and think most of their wonderful powers and great age. The Pandits, or learned class, and educated Hindus in general, have a different view. They say that Mahatmas are men or souls with unlimited knowledge of natural laws and of men's history and development. They claim also that the Mahatmas, or Rishis, as they sometimes call them, have preserved the knowledge of all natural laws for ages, not only by tradition among their disciples, but also by actual records and in libraries existing somewhere in the many underground temples and passages in India. Some believers assert that there are also stores of books and records in secluded parts all over the part of Tibet, which is not known to Europeans, access to them being possible only for the Mahatmas and adepts. The credence given to such a universal theory grows out of an old Indian doctrine that man is a spiritual being, a soul, in other words, and that this soul takes on different bodies from life to life on earth in order at last to arrive at such perfect knowledge, through repeated experience as to enable one to assume a body fit to be the dwelling place of a Mahatma or perfected soul. Then they say that particular soul becomes a spiritual helper to mankind. The perfected men are said to know the truth about the genesis of worlds and systems, as well as the development of men upon this and other planets. Were such doctrines held only in India, it would be natural to pass the subject by with this brief mention. But when it is found that the large body of people in America and Europe hold the same beliefs, it is interesting to note that such an un-Western development of thought. The Theosophical Society was founded in New York in 1875 with the avowed object of forming a nucleus for a universal brotherhood, and its founders state that they believe the Indian Mahatmas directed them to establish such a society. Since its foundation, it has gained members in all countries, including people of wealth as well as those in moderate circumstances and the highly cultured also. When in its ranks there flourish beliefs in the Mahatmas of India and in reincarnation and its twin doctrine, karma. This last holds that no power, human or divine, can save one from the consequences of acts performed, and that in this life we are experiencing the results due to us for all acts and thoughts which were ours in the preceding incarnation.
Following is a reading of a section of letters that have helped me. Letters that have helped me was based on a correspondence between William Q. Judge and Jasper Niemand. It went on for many years. They were very close acquaintances. And a lot of inspiration can be derived from that particular work, as we see Judge in a very personal way. But published in a later edition of Letters That Have Helped Me is the following biographical sketch, lightly edited for time. William Quan Judge, son of Alice Mary Quan and Frederick H. Judge, was born in Dublin, Ireland on April 13, 1851. His father was a Mason and a student of mysticism. His mother died in early life, bearing a seventh child. Young William was brought up in Dublin until his 13th year, when his father moved the motherless family to the United States, arriving in New York on July 14, 1864. There's little to be said of William's earliest childhood, though we hear of a memorable illness of his seventh year, an illness supposed to be mortal. The physician declared him to be dying and then dead. But in the outburst of grief which followed the announcement, it was discovered that the child had revived and that all was well with him. During convalescence, the boy showed aptitudes and knowledge never before displayed, exciting wonderment and questioning among his elders as to when and how he had learned all these new things. He seemed the same and yet not the same. He seemed to be studied anew by his family, and while no one knew that he had ever learned to read, from his recovery in his eighth year, we find him devouring the contents of all the books he could obtain, relating to mesmerism, phrenology, character reading, religion, magic, Rosicrucianism, and deeply absorbed in the Book of Revelation, trying to discover its real meaning. There is perhaps a deeper story to be told here, though constraints of time won't allow a full account. Mr. Judge told the story in the form of an occult novel, as he called it, of just such a boy dying in Europe, whose body is borrowed by an Indian Raja as fulfillment of his vows to serve humanity. The Raja goes to sleep in his compound in India to awaken in the European boy's body, and then returns as the Raja when the boy sleeps, and continues on this work indefinitely. Only Mr. Judge knows to what degree this tale is autobiographical, but it certainly goes a long way to explain not only his uncanny aptitude in childhood, but also his ability later in life to produce such definitive translations of Sanskrit works, such as the Patanjali's Yoga Aphorisms and the Bhagavad-Gita. Perhaps the magnetic link so abruptly renewed in his illness was never fully vitalized in a physical sense, for the lad never acquired a strong physique. Without being sickly, he was frail, but indomitable and persevering beyond his years. An anecdote of his boyhood illustrates these traits. He was with other boys upon the bank of a stream. His companions swam to an island a little way off from the bank. From the vantage ground, they jeered and mocked their younger comrade, who could not swim. The small William's heart rose hot within him. He plunged into the water, resolved to get to that island or perish. When out of his depth, he let himself sink, touched bottom, ran a few steps on the river's bed, rose, kicked, sank, took a step and another, repeated the process, and thus struggling, rising, sinking, scrambling, and above all, holding his breath. He actually reached the margin of the island, to be drawn out half unconscious by his astonished playfellows. Nothing could be more characteristic of Mr. Judge. Mr. Judge's father, with his children, lived for a brief period at the Old Merchants Hotel in Cortlandt Street, New York, next to 10th Street, and then settled in Brooklyn. William began work in New York as a clerk, and afterwards entered the law office of George P. Andrews, who later became judge of the Supreme Court of New York. There, the lad studied law while living with his father, who, however, died soon after. On coming of age, William Q. Judge was naturalized as a U.S. citizen in April of 1872. In May of that year, he was admitted as a lawyer to the Bar of New York. His conspicuous traits in the practice of commercial law, which became his specialty, were his thoroughness, his inflexible persistence, and his industry, which won the respect of employers and clients alike. As was said of him then and later, quote, Judge would walk over red-hot plowshares from here to India to do his duty. In 1874, he married Ella M. Smith of Brooklyn, by whom he had one child, a little girl of great charm and promise, whose death in early childhood was long a source of deep, though quiet, sorrow to both. Mr. Judge, especially, was a great lover of children, and had the gift of attracting them around him. If he sketched on the deck of a steamer, the children would sidle up, coming nearer and nearer, until they were leaning against him or perching wherever a resting place could be had, often before he had seemed to notice their presence. The children of his friends always gave him joyous welcome, and not infrequently he was dragged to the floor, the common playground, amid their toys. A child, in the company where he was sure to find the haven of his arms at last, and nestled there, while the metaphysical discussion went on above its curls. But, however animated the argument, you would not find that small form, so gently cradled, to be ever so little disturbed. Soon after his marriage, Mr. Judge heard of Madame Blavatsky. He came across a book which greatly interested him, People from the Other World, by Henry Steele Alcott. Mr. Judge wrote to Alcott, asking for the address of a good medium, for at this time the tide of occult inquiry and speculation had just set in, and the experiences of a number of people, including those of Madame Blavatsky at the Eddy homestead, were the talk of all the world. While no medium was forthcoming, Mr. Judge was invited to call upon HBB. The call was paid at her room on Irving Place in New York. H.P. Blavatsky then, for the first time in this life, met her most devoted pupil and friend face to face in a relationship which continued unbroken, quote, till death and after, unquote, as HPB herself put it. Storms there were, no doubt, as well as full of sunshine, for the pupil was a powerful mind and the teacher was the Sphinx of her era, so that intellectual tussles followed as a natural consequence. But whatever the pupil thought of the teacher was said to her boldly, not a doubt nor a fear concealed when these arose, as arise they must when the hour of occult teaching and trial dawns. That HPB honored this openness is evidenced by her long letters. There are some of 48 pages in which many a puzzle is explained with profound affection. Mr. Judge spent much of his time with HPB in New York at Irving Place, in study, under her direction and instruction, and helped her with Isis Unveiled. He was one of the number present at her rooms on September 7, 1875, when the first proposal for the Theosophical Society was made and its organization begun. Isis Unveiled was published in 1877, and a little over a year later, Madame Blavatsky and Colonel Alcott went to India, while Mr. Judge was left to carry on the TS in New York as best he could. These three, Blavatsky, Alcott, and Judge, being, as HBB subsequently wrote, the only founders who remained true to the cause and to the society. It was a position in which the young lawyer seemed quite overweighted, but he did all that he could. He was a disciple under trial, soon to be accepted and recognized, but already, so far as this life goes, a neophyte, one of a band who have taken the vow of interior poverty and whose unseen and unrecorded work is regarded as being of far more importance than exterior visible work. The main current of such lives runs underground. Already, H.P. Blavatsky had written and said that he had been a part of herself and of the Great Lodge, quote, for eons past, unquote. And that was one of those, and that he was one of those tried egos who have reincarnated several times immediately after death, assisted to do so, and without devaconic rest, in order to continue his lodge work. Mr. Judge's was a difficult task indeed when HPB, who was then the one great exponent, had left the field, and the curiosity and interest excited by her original and striking mission had died down. The TS, the Theosophical Society, was henceforth to subsist on its philosophical basis, and this, after long years of toil and unyielding persistence, was the point attained by Mr. Judge. From his 23rd year until his death, his best efforts and all the fiery energies of his undaunted soul were given to this work. We have a picture of him from his own words, opening meetings, reading a chapter of the Bhagavad-Gita, entering minutes, and carrying on all the details of the same, even though he was the only person present at the meeting. And this he did time after time, determined that there would be a society. Will, such as this, makes its way through every obstacle. Through his unremitting labor, he built up the TS in America, aiding the movement as well in all parts of the world, and winning from the master the name of resuscitator of Theosophy in America. His motto in those days was promulgation, not speculation. Theosophy, he said, is a cry of the soul. The work went slowly at first. There was no great activity, but the link was kept unbroken, and correspondence with HPB was brisk. The shadow portrayed in those letters lifted. The disciple came to know, even as he was known, in 1888, we find HPB writing in certain official documents of him as being then, quote, a chela of 13 years standing, with trust reposed in him, unquote, and, quote, the chief and sole agent of the Zion Lodge in America, unquote. This, it will be remembered, is the name by which that, what is called the lodge, is known in Tibet. Mr. Judge had been in South America, where HBB said there was a branch of the Great Lodge, and where he saw many strange things. In that country, he contracted the dreaded Chagas fever, probably meant to mean Chagas disease, a parasitic infection found mainly in rural Latin America, which racks the system of its victims as by fire, often carrying them off in the 20th year. Mr. Judge was always a great sufferer from this torturing disease, though he never stayed his work for it, and 1896 was the 20th year. To Europe he went, too, in 1884, meeting HPB in Paris and spending some little time with her there, and thence to India, where he arrived after the outbreak of the Cologne scandal. After a brief stay there, Mr. Judge returned to America and the duties of his professional and theosophical life. The moment was critical, a turning point. As so often happens, the scandal attracted public attention to the Theosophical Society, and letters of inquiry began to pour in. Mr. Judge seized the tide at the flood and carried the bark of the society on to wider fortunes. The press took up the matter, reporters called, inquirers became members. The community became aware of the quiet, forceful worker in its midst. His method and his manner won the respect of those who heard him. The press began to accept his articles on Theosophy and later on those of others. Branch societies were established, and Judge started the journal The Path in 1886 to give them a continuous flow of spiritual thought. He became a literary fountain from whom flowed a ceaseless stream of brilliant and inspiring teachings. He wrote many of the articles for The Path under various pseudonyms, and H.P. Blavatsky called its contents pure Buddhi. In 1888, an epitome of Theosophy was published and widely read. Robert Crosbie read it about 1890 and joined the Boston branch of the Theosophical Society. When Judge met him for the first time, he said, "Crosbie, you are on my list." Crosbie soon became the most energetic worker in the Boston branch, and then in 1909 was the founder of the United Lodge of Theosophists. As well as many articles, 1889 saw the publication of the Theosophical Forum, which continued under Judge's direction until his death, and the Yoga Aphorisms of Patanjali. Echoes from the Orient appeared in 1890, followed by a rendition of the Bhagavad-Gita and the first series of Letters That Have Helped Me in 1893. In 1893, the Ocean of Theosophy appeared. Mr. Judge lectured all over the United States and did the work of several men. Every spare moment was given to Theosophy and taken from his meals and his rest. Finally, when the New York headquarters were acquired, and when the work had increased to large proportions, Mr. Judge relinquished his profession and gave his entire life and time to the society. His health, always frail, continued to give way. A day free from pain was rare with him. Often he was in very real danger. But always he was scornful of every suffering, working when another man would have been prone, when his friends and doctors were shocked at his being about at all. As the TS grew, his working staff grew also, but he outworked and outtired them all. Dauntless, indomitable, he was ever inaugurating fresh plans of work. He had his sorrows too, but the cheerfulness of his aspect, his undaunted energy, never failed him. To those who would ask his advice in the crises which were wont to shake the tree of the TS, he would make answer, "Work, work, work for Theosophy." J. judge had warned his closest workers at the end of 1894 that the karma of his body dictated that it should die in 1895, though it might be made to survive by extraordinary means. Early in the year, he went to Mineral Wells, Texas, for a few weeks' rest. After the Boston Convention in 1895, he again traveled, but the strain of events began to show, curtailing his public engagements. He continued to write and make plans into 1896. On March 21st, at about 9 a.m., he quietly passed from this world after delivering an occult aphorism, quote, "There should be calmness, hold fast, go slow." William Q. Judge's claim upon us was that of the work. The work was his ideal. He valued men and women by their theosophical work and the spirit in which that work was done. He held right thought to be the best work. He worked with anyone who was willing to do work in the real sense, careless whether such were personal friends, strangers, or active or secret foes. The mind of Mr. Judge had a very pronounced duality. It was immensely practical, and also profoundly mystical. As a man of business, he was successful. It was once said of him by a wealthy merchant that he was a man who could have sold anything he undertook to sell. His practical gift has its most brilliant exposition in his power of organization. He is indeed a master builder. And to this faculty, TS in America owes its strength and its growth. He was far-seeing, prompt and resourceful in emergency, never deterred by expediency, mere public opinion, nor by any consideration of a personal nature, from carrying out that which he had resolved to do. He fears nothing except his own conscience. When plans of work were under consideration, he consulted all the principal workers and members living in the districts for which the plan was proposed. He collated the opinions of all and was guided by those which were of worth, and thus, like an able general, he never moved far from his base of supplies, but carried his support with him. As a mystic, Mr. Judge had another office, simple yet profound, rarely visible on the surface, yet luminous. In the years 1887 to 88, he wrote by the order of the master and to two friends who were now husband and wife, a series of letters published under the title, Letters That Have Helped Me. It would be difficult to trace the lives in which these letters have been as a light to the soul. In them is found that gift which the occultist, who has in any degree become, must possess in rare perfection, the art of evolving souls. For thus act the bearers of the flame, the brethren of the burning heart. From one generation to another, such are the servants of Krishna, such are the evolvers of soul, and those who have come into closer contact with the man of whom the master wrote in 1887 through HPB that, quote, "he of all chelas suffers most and asks or even expects the least," unquote. Those who have worked with true devotion and in the true spirit with William Q. Judge, whether near or far in the body, know well the uplifting, widening force which flows through him, ripening the character, developing the higher nature, and letting patience have her perfect work. Working thus on varied planes, the life of William Q. Judge goes on its quiet way. Its depths lie hidden, but from them wells an irresistible force that stimulates to devotion, to self-denial, to unsparing, unceasing activity for the world. A friend to all men and women, he was yet impersonal always. Personal flattery or personal following he met with impatience, and soon would set the offender upon his own feet. To him, the ideal friend was one who teaches us to stand on our own base, to rely upon the inner self, and this was the part of friendship as he himself played it. A lady being asked if she had not received psychic teachings from Mr. Judge replied, quote, "I will tell you the kind of psychic teaching he gave me. It was this, cast no one out of your heart." So we found him ever accepting all, as in the one self, closing no door to anyone, leaving the way always open to all who may wish to return to him or to the work, excluding none who are in that work, whether friend or foe, offering a hand to his adversaries, and ready to offer it again when it is rejected, conquering personal animosity by the sheer force of his character as he goes steadily on with that work.
comes from Mr. Robert Crosbie in memory of William Juan Judge. Speaking of Mr. Judge, as anybody might have known him, as a human being like ourselves, he was humble, unassuming, modest, strong, patient, meek, courageous, an organizer beyond comparison, with powers similar to those possessed by HPB, and never using them in any way but to smooth the path for those who desire to follow the road of knowledge. He was kind and patient, as we do not often find, with tremendous forcefulness. He had extraordinary powers of organization, with a perception that could look into the very motives and minds of others, could see traitors around him, could read the hearts of those desirous of injuring him, and yet, in all his intercourse with them, paving the way for them, remaining ever kind. For the one who most injured him, he had only this to say when friends about him spoke their denunciations. Quote, "Never mind what others do. Put no one out of your heart. Go on with the work you see. Work will tell in time, and all these follies of others, follies of ignorance, will fall to nothing. Then when the time comes, we will all have gained strength. When those who have fallen away for a while come back, there we will be with open arms, as strong brothers, to help them find the path and smooth out the effects of errors that have been created through ignorance." His was a wonderful knowledge, and his was a wonderful power, but we know, perhaps some of us do, at all events, that what was really the cornerstone was rejected of the builders. That being was soon neglected, and his works neglected by those who should have seen and known. The whole misunderstanding, which finally led to the disruption of the Theosophical Society, lies at that very point. HPB and William Kwan Judge cannot be separated. They came together, they work together, and they are together. Understanding this, that there was no link missing in the chain of those who work in the cause, constitutes the door that opens avenues of knowledge to those who seek. To imagine that knowledge can come in any other way than through the regularly developed channels is to make the greatest mistake. In that chain of being, reaching from the very highest down to us, no link can be missed. We cannot pass over the link immediately above us. That link must be understood before we can pass to a still higher one. So, while the philosophy recorded has been given out, its ideas spread throughout the world by different societies, each member needs to answer for himself the question, does he really know the truth of the philosophy? Is he able to see from the heart out? Does he know the straight line of communication, or is he merely following statements and claims made? The door for the Westerners is through William Kwan Judge, just as the door for the world was through HPB. Those who fail in that recognition must fail in obtaining the benefits that flow from the great communication. This finalizes our program for today. Thank you for coming and participating. Now we will join hands and reestablish our links. Thank you.